This is a great story from the gospel. I just love this story. And part of it's because as a pastor, more than anything, I want to help people connect to God with the sacred, the holy, the ground of all being, as some theologians call it, or the one who is both transcendent and immanent. And I'm also a poet of sorts. Probably my purpose in being a poet is much the same, to connect to life, which is a gift, and I think whenever you have a gift, there must be a giver. I don't always know the best way for someone else to connect with God. So much really depends on personality and temperament, desire, interest, passion. And so much depends on the kind of spiritual community that a person has formed around them to share the journey that they're on. Which leads me to my opening question this morning, which is, how helpful is that word journey in describing what it means to be a person of faith, or a person who's seeking a deeper truth about being alive? How helpful is that word journey for you? In what ways do you believe that you are on a journey going somewhere? In my 20s, I went out and decided I wanted to be a backpacker. And I went and bought this brand new backpack, and it fit me perfectly, and it was great. I had this kind of romantic idea of what it was going to be like to be out in the wilderness, entering this, you know, the natural world of creation and roughing it, you know, really, truly roughing it, because I had done some camping, so I thought I could do this. And the few times I did venture out with my backpack and a buddy or a family member did not go so well. They were trips that ended prematurely, in fact, for reasons I don't really need to go into. Who knew that backpacking could be so hard? Now, Dr. M. Scott Peck, I don't know if you recognize that name or not, but he wrote a series of books on the road less traveled, and I'll never forget the opening line of his first book, which is simply, "Life is difficult. Life is difficult." And the second book he began with the observation, "Life is complex." In the third book, his opening words were, "There are no easy answers." And that just about sums it up as far as I'm concerned. Those three phrases, life is difficult, it's complex, there are no easy answers. You and I are on a spiritual journey, and it's also a human journey, right? It's a journey toward becoming more fully human, more fully alive to the breath of God that blows throughout all of creation. Earth's crammed with heaven, according to poet Elizabeth Barrett Browning, and every common bush afire with God. However, it does require that we take our shoes off, because it is holy ground. The spiritual journey we're on is a fascinating blend of relationships, work, health, goals, constant learning, persistent evolving, mistakes, having boundaries that are not impermeable but at least offer us some safety and protection from unnecessary harm, coping mechanisms, dreams, hopes, losses, grief, and joy. It's a journey that leads somewhere, and it's often difficult, almost always complex, and there are no easy answers. From a theological point of view, I would say that our journey is home. And our home, again from a theological perspective, is with God or in God. But I'm really getting ahead of myself a little at this point. The gospel story today, known as the Walk to Emmaus, is about two disciples, a few days from after the death of Jesus, going on this 7-mile journey back to the familiar ground of their lives, their work, and their community. And it turns out to be a journey, as simple as it was, as normal as it sort of was, that forever changes them. Because along the way, a number of things happen to alter their way of seeing the world and their way of being in the world. Before I kind of start exploring this story, I'd like to begin with a prayer by Thomas Merton. God, we have no idea where we are going. We do not see the road ahead of us. We cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do we really know ourselves. And the fact that we think we are following your will does not mean that we are actually doing so. But we believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you. And we hope we have that desire in all that we are doing. We hope that we will never do anything apart from that desire. And we know that if we do this, you will lead us by the right road, though we may know nothing about it. Therefore, we will trust you always, though we may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death. We will not fear, for you are ever with us, and you will never leave us to face our perils alone. Amen. I'm wondering if it's possible to lower this mic just slightly.
Just pull it down.
Just pull it down.
Yeah, there you go.
All right. So, beginning with just the first part of this story, verses 13 to 17, which is part of what was read there today, it seems that at dawn, before the sun had risen, some women went to the tomb of Jesus to properly wash his corpse and prepare it for burial. And when they arrived, of course, they had this vision involving angels informing them that Jesus had been raised and that they shouldn't go looking for the living among the dead. They hurried back to the other disciples to tell them what they had seen and heard, but the disciples, being products of the patriarchal world as they were, didn't believe the women, for their words struck them as nonsense. Mistake number one for the men in this story. However, Peter did run to the tomb to see that it was empty and that there was only this linen cloth inside. That same day, two disciples are returning to Emmaus, talking about the events of the last few days since they last ate a meal with Jesus. Their hearts are grief-stricken. Perhaps you can imagine the hopelessness and the helplessness they felt. Their teacher, mentor, guide, friend, in whom they placed their trust to change the world, had been killed right before their eyes. Evil had had its day of triumph. The whole situation seemed utterly final and irreversible. Hopes dashed, hearts broken, fears raised. They walked the long road home. They were heading back to find some comfort in the life that they once knew. Yet everything had changed. The sky was darker, the clouds hung lower, the brightness of life they had felt with Jesus was burning itself out, it seemed. They had been through a devastating loss and were marked by grief. Suddenly a stranger comes alongside them. They drop their voices. He asks, "What are you talking about as you walk along?" This question stops them in their tracks. They stood still, Luke says, suggesting that when God enters a conversation we think we're having with one another, when our horizontal perspective on this human condition is somehow intersected by the vertical perspective of God's word, we cannot but find our lost selves standing still. We have surely come to a crossroad. At issue are not the miles before us, but the moment at hand and the eternity that has just invaded it. What are the losses in our lives, in your life? What are the griefs that you are experiencing or have experienced recently? Jesus walks alongside us as we walk with our loss and grief. The next part of the story, we look at verses 18 through 29, kind of the middle section, and I want to tell it from the perspective of the two traveling companions. While on the road, they're talking about, they're talking as though nothing more than the death has happened. That's the only thing they can really see. They wonder really what to make of the troubles they've seen and where they might look for some sign of hope. After being asked what they are talking about, here's what happens through their eyes, from their perspective. One of us replies, "Are you kidding? Are you the only person in this whole region who doesn't know what all that's been happening in Jerusalem? Like what? The stranger asks. We tell him about Jesus, that he was clearly a prophet who said and did amazing things. We tell him how the religious and political leaders came together to arrest him. We go into some detail about the crucifixion on Friday. We had hoped, one of us says, and pauses, we had hoped that this Jesus was the one who was going to turn things around for Israel, that he would set us free from the Roman occupation. Now, we all bring, let me just pause here for a moment, we all bring our we had hoped moments to this text, right? We had hoped it wasn't cancer. We had hoped the relationship wouldn't end. We had hoped the war could be averted. We had hoped the terrible wound would heal and we could be normal again. We had hoped. Well, jumping back into the story, we walk on a few steps and he adds, and this morning was the third day since his death, and some women from our group told us that they had a vision of angels and said, who said he was alive. It's pretty clear from the tone of his voice that none of us take the report of the women very seriously. That's when the stranger interrupts. You just don't get it, do you? This is exactly what the prophet said would happen. They have been telling us all along that the liberator would have to suffer and die like this before entering his glory. And as we continue walking, he starts explaining things to us from scriptures. He begins with Moses, and step by step, he shows us the pattern of God's work in history, culminating in what happened in Jerusalem in recent days. God calls someone to proclaim God's will. Resistance and rejection follow, often culminating in an expulsion or murder to silence the speaker. But this is a sign. This isn't a sign of defeat. This is the only way God's most important messages are ever heard, through someone on the verge of being rejected. God's word doesn't come in dominating, crushing force. It comes only in vulnerability, in weakness, in gentleness, just as we have seen over this last week. At this point, we realize we've reached home already, and as we slow down, the stranger just keeps walking. We plead with him to stay here with us, since it's getting late and will soon be dark. So he comes in, and we sit down at our little table for a meal. He reaches to the center of the table and takes a loaf of bread and gives thanks for it. He breaks it and hands a piece of it to each of us, and it hits us at the same moment. This isn't a stranger. It couldn't be. Yes, this is Jesus. We each look down at the fragment of bread in our hands, and when we look back up to the stranger, he's gone. Imagine for a moment this scene. When the risen Christ breaks the bread and suddenly disappears. Hold that moment of disappearance in your mind and open your heart to the possibility of absence becoming fullness. From the oral tradition of Zen Buddhism, we hear this story. A disciple asked the master, "Is there anything more wonderful than the beauty of creation?" After a long pause, the master answered, "Yes, there is." "What could that possibly be?" inquired the disciple. This time the master's response was delivered swiftly. "Your own awareness and appreciation of the wonders of creation." In the Emmaus story, Christ opens the eyes of those who walk with a willingness to learn how and where God is present. The two disciples are able to pause to notice that something has changed with the appearance of the stranger who accompanies them. I'm reminded of the deep faith of Teilhard de Chardin in the abiding presence of God that allowed him to pray like this. He said, "Lord, grant that I may see, that I may see you, that I may see and feel you present in all things and only in all things. And so I want to say that contemplation is an aspect of our Christian faith that can take the form of standing in grateful awe before the dazzling colors of a rose garden, let's say, or the majestic shapes of Yosemite's stone monuments. It can occur when taking delight in a sunset or marveling over the sparkling beauty of a star-studded sky. 7 years ago, Dallas and I went up to Lake Tahoe for a long weekend, and it was Sunday morning, and we didn't go to church. But I did look out the window, and I wrote this poem. It's called Praying on Sunday. On a Sunday morning like this, I am routinely in my study gathering words to express people's prayers, revisiting my sermon for flow and transitions, giving thought to a benediction. Today I look out at towering pines, snow-brushed hills, blue sky meeting bluer water, birds of the air and creatures of the earth, my study renovated and redecorated by all that God has made. This life, a solitary path toward tomorrow's tomorrow, one day so often meeting the next with little more than the passing recognition that time flees before us, we grow older, we die. This life is a prayer, written on the tips of wings and branches, carried on the breath of the winds, lived upon the altar of the earth. On a Sunday morning like this, there is holy ground everywhere I look. I enter my temporary study and prepare to pray, my heart spilling over with gratitude. The Emmaus story is a foundational one for the church, for Christians. We lay our deepest we had hoped into this master narrative of Emmaus, and we begin to connect our own personal disappointed hopes into the larger journey of transformed hope. The Emmaus story helps us begin to see our own story with new eyes, with the eyes of recognition, with the eyes of resurrection. It invites us to see Jesus in every place and time in which we live, to see Jesus accompanying us on the road. A commitment to living contemplatively does not require that we leave home in search of a mountain or a desert hideaway where we can dwell in seclusion and uninterrupted meditation. Rather, a contemplative attitude challenges us to take in our existing reality with spiritually sensitive eyes. Indian Jesuit Anthony DeMello recounts an instructive exchange between a disciple and a spiritual master that highlights the importance of looking carefully at everything that surrounds us in order to discover God's presence everywhere. The disciple began this conversation saying, "For years I have been seeking God. I have sought him everywhere that he is said to be, on mountain peaks, the vastness of the desert, the silence of the cloister, and the dwellings of the poor." In reply, the master asks, "Have you found him?" "No, I have not," answered the disciple. "Have you?" What could the master say? The evening sun was sending shafts of golden light into the room. Hundreds of sparrows were twittering on a nearby banyan tree. In the distance, one could hear the sound of highway traffic. A mosquito droned a warning that it was going to strike. And yet this man could sit there and say that he had not found God. After a while, the disappointed disciple left to search elsewhere. In another story entitled The Little Fish, DeMello nicely encapsulates the wisdom of this spiritual master. "Excuse me," said an ocean fish, "you are older than I. So can you tell me where to find this thing they call the ocean?" "The ocean," said the older fish, "is the thing you are in now." "Oh, this? But this is water." "What I'm seeking is the ocean," said the disappointed fish, as he swam away to search elsewhere. The spiritual lesson to us is clear. There isn't anything to look for. All you have to do is look. "Don't expect to arrive at a place of knowing," says Pastor Steve Garnes Holmes, as he reflects on the disciples' hearts burning within them. "You are on the road of discovery, my friend, and the flame in your heart will only inconstantly let you know that there also walks the beloved who yearns only for this one passionate delight above all the glories of heaven. Every moment, even the least memorable, the least noticed at all, simply to be with you." Anne Lamott tells a story about a little 7-year-old girl who became lost one day and couldn't find her way home. The little girl ran up and down the streets of the big city where they lived, but she couldn't find a single landmark, and she started to get very frightened. Finally, a police officer stopped to help her and put her in the passenger seat of his car, and they drove around until she finally saw her church. She pointed it out to the policeman, and then she told him firmly, "You can let me out now. This is my church, and I can always find my way home from here." The road that we are on, the journey that we are on, leads home to the unconditional love and acceptance of God. No matter what the world says, no matter what the church and its archaic, unbiblical, harmful laws might say, no matter what anyone says, you and I are beloved children of God. May we recognize the risen Christ along the way in our losses and griefs, in our sorrows and disappointments, in our joys and celebrations, and perhaps most stunningly in the ordinary daily moments when we suddenly realize that we are walking on holy ground. May we learn to be companions with others, to be the body of Christ for the world, to be a place where hope is renewed by the power of the resurrection. Marcus Borg often ended his lectures with this prayer, and I'll end with it as well. "Life is short. We do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. So be quick to love. Make haste to be kind."